shall not be prohibited by the Congress prior to the year 1808, but a tax or duty may be imposed on such importation not exceeding $10 for each person.
Importation of persons was a euphemism. The framers were not so indelicate as to use the word slave. It was an anomalous provision, containing as it did the only date in the Constitution and moreover the only price, the $10 duty limit, which guaranteed that the African slave trade could not be taxed out of existence. The $10 duty was never imposed.
That constitutionally stipulated deadline of January 1st, 1808 is from our perspective one of the most important dates in American history, signaling as it does the transformation of the United States slavery industry. For this reason, 1808 is also an essential date for understanding the making of African American culture. Kidnapped Africans have been arriving for almost 200 years, repeatedly re-Africanizing American culture. No longer. The child was separated from the ancestors.
With the changeover to a domestic slave trade, the long-established Afro-Chesapeake culture of Virginia and Maryland was diffused southward over several decades. Meanwhile, there was an overland march westward from the more recently Africanized Lowcountry of Carolina and Georgia. The two collided with each other in the presence of the smaller but potent Creolized culture of Catholic Afro-Louisiana.
And take it, Donald Harrison.
Yeah.
At which point we have some music. The audiobook is 25 CDs. This does weigh 3 pounds. But it's quite thorough. But I think that's enough to read for right now. This is just an amazing experience to feel this much energy in this tiny little room, you know. It's really amazing to be here, and so happy that we got to finally bring this to Detroit. I'm just like so thrilled. If anybody, usually at this point we kick it, and if anybody got a question, an answer, a comment, keep your comments fairly brief, please.
We're going to have questions, comments, and compliments to our people. I'll manage that, and you're number one.
Okay, I'm moderator.
You're the moderator. Okay, great.
I'm going to manage that.
I love having a moderator.
Okay. Number one. Who else? Two, three.
I want to compliment you for the book.
Thank you, sir.
It was a thrilling read. You took away my initial question with your allusion to Thomas Jefferson's letter. So I will move further north than Maryland. In the wake of the Revolutionary War, all of the northern states except Vermont adopted gradual emancipation laws. I understand that in one or two of the states there were some limits placed on the ability of owners to anticipate the emancipation date by selling off their slaves. But it's my understanding that in most of the states, they didn't do that. To what extent have you looked at the movement of slaves from Pennsylvania, New York, New Jersey,
New York,
and so forth, south?
Yeah, New York slave owners sold a bunch of them down south before slavery was phased out. Might also add in New Jersey, they kept slavery for a while under the euphemism apprentice. It was a sort of a semi, it was still basically slavery. But just bear in mind, these numbers were, there certainly were people from the north coming down. I can't give you a number, but what I can tell you, it was very tiny by comparison, because there was no plantation culture in the north. There were not large populations of enslaved people, and most enslaved people were not employed in the kind of gang labor that they would be made to do in the, you know, in the cotton kingdom. So, and there was, of course, very importantly, I mean, the importance of the free community of color throughout this history in the North and in the South just cannot be overestimated. It's just the, you may have read 12 Years a Slave, you know, which the remarkable slave narrative that tells the story of Solomon Northup, the only slave narrative by a musician, and also the only one by someone who had been free and then enslaved and then free again. So it's quite remarkable, and it's also dramatic. I'm sure you saw the movie. There are lots more slave narratives that would make great movies, but I digress. Solomon Northup, going down south and coming back up, was able to tell his, because he could get free, was able to tell his story. But we just don't have these stories for the most part. The slave narratives that were published in the 19th century, there's a little more than 100 of them. How many millions of stories do these have to stand in for?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Number two.
So biology says that if a black and a white were to have a child, that child would be neither black or white. But in America, that child is black.
Mm-hmm.
In your investigation and studying, when did that idea of 1 ounce of black blood make you black? Did you find legislative enactments sort of supporting that idea?
It was not, no, not really. The earliest thing I've been more concerned about the law of the partus sequitur ventrum, the status of the newborn follows the status of the womb, which it was almost more important to know whether you were free or slave. And of course, there were free black people, free people of color, who owned slaves, and there were blonde-haired, blue-eyed people sold on the auction block who had been born to an enslaved mother. So it's a slightly different issue. But you wanted to say something?
Oh, Thomas Jefferson tried to figure this out mathematically.
Yeah.
How many generations would it take to no longer be a one drop? And I forget, how many generations?
He did not use the phrase one drop.
No, he didn't use that phrase, but it was like, when would it no longer be...
Which he had a real serious need to know, because two of his 1/8 black children were allowed to disappear off and pass for white and vanish from the historical record.
It shows up in court cases for one drop rule.
Yeah.
In South Carolina.
Yeah.
The earliest case that I'm aware of is a South Carolina case.
The impact of my question is that African Americans had bought into this idea. And I think the idea originally served the plantation economy, because if I were a master and I fathered 20 kids, they could all be slaves.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, it goes against biology, but our president is considered black.
Yep.
He's 23 of his genes are from his mom and 23 are from his dad. And so how does he get to be black and not white?
Well, I might say that the American Anthropological Association statement on race, you can start with that as an example. I mean, it's a cultural concept. It's not, race is not a useful biological concept. In terms of the being black or white, it's the process just kept going generation by generation. The enslaved population kept getting lighter. You know how all this works. I want to just note that anthropologists today use the term socially black or socially white. I have seen this done to describe, so that they're not seen as buying into this concept themselves, but we can all agree that socially black and socially white is a real thing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I answered your question or not, but.
You're gonna be number seven. Number four?
I don't have anything profound to say. I heard you today on the radio, NPR with Stephen Henderson, and your presentation was excellent, absolutely excellent. And I want to applaud you for your work, and I'm here to buy your book.
You know, all right.
I will say, though, that also, Stephen Henderson is such a good interviewer, and was so, had his shit was so together, and he was so at ease that he made it possible to just flow naturally, and the people who called in were also, I mean, it felt like playing music with a good band, which is what good radio usually is like in my experience.
Number four?
My question is about the chain gangs and the prisons. The chain gangs, did it start in the South and did they bring it up to the North? And was the system corrupt, our jail system? I mean, do you have things like that in your book since it's so big? I mean, I didn't want to get up the exact subject, but
we don't answer. I have not researched the exact question that you phrased.
Okay.
So I won't freestyle an answer, except to note that, I mean, the you know that infamous exception in the 13th Amendment, right? The the one that let me see. I'll try to find this spot quickly.
Involuntary servitude except for punishment.
That's right. Exactly. Neither slavery nor, this is the 13th Amendment, neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as a punishment for crime whereof the party shall have been duly convicted, shall exist within the United States or any place subject to their jurisdiction. Now, that's a very vaguely worded clause, and it's possible to argue and litigate about what it means. You could interpret it that the Constitution still permits slavery if you're a convict. Interestingly, this ambiguity goes back to Jefferson. Jefferson, who was a big enthusiast of modern surveillance-type prisons, they copied the language of the Northwest Ordinance of 1787, which drew on Jefferson's draft of the land ordinance of 1784, in which he imagined a place that would be free except for there shall be neither slavery nor involuntary servitude in any of the said states otherwise than in punishment of crimes or of dire. So it's really, this ambiguity goes exactly, what is American penology supposed to consist of, and how can we possibly justify the horrific conditions that in which American prisoners must live? I mean, this question goes back to Jefferson.
Number five.
Yeah, 2 points. One is appreciation. I really appreciate the narrative and the specificity and realness of the writing. It brought home to me the suffering right there, and I'm a Palestinian. It reminds me of The Lemon Tree, which is another writing about the Palestinian Holocaust in 1948. And the writer actually writes it in real terms, and it sounds like fiction, but it really was, everything was a documentary. So that's the appreciation part. But the second part is out of ignorance. How is it that Canada does not have any slaves?
Okay, first of all, slavery in the United States was a creation of Anglo-Americans who came to the eastern seaboard, and those, slavery existed everywhere at first, in all the colonies. But the northern colonies never developed plantation labor. They didn't import, we were talking about this before, didn't import large numbers of slaves. But in as Virginia got its tobacco crop going and could not get it worked satisfactorily by other people, they found slavery to be their solution. Meanwhile, South Carolina, which was founded to be slave traders' heaven, four of the eight lords proprietors who founded South Carolina were members of the Royal African Company Board. South Carolina was founded as an expansion slot for Barbados. And it was always intended to be the slave trading empire. Right up to secession, they saw themselves as the slave owning empire that would cover the entire hemisphere. So these were out of peculiar conditions in the American South, this massive industrialization of slavery. In Canada, where there were no plantations and no large groups of black people, there would be no, these large numbers of people would never have been imported. But also,
for a long time, Canada was disputed between France and Britain. And both France and Britain's principal interest in the territory of Canada, its interior, the area that we consider as the boundary now between Canada and the United States, their interest was in keeping the Native Americans working the fur trade. So if you see, we see what happened here in the United States when Andrew Jackson removed the Indians from what becomes called the Cotton Kingdom. It was then made safe for plantation slavery and those kinds of crops. So not only did Canada not have a climate for that kind of cash crop, they already had a cash crop, which was the fur trade. We cannot underestimate how important that fur trade was to the development of the history of North America.
Including Detroit. Detroit.
Yes.
The first North American millionaire.
Yeah.
Astor.
Yes. Yeah, no matter. I mean, and France and England, and then the United States, when it became the United States, they continued to fight over control of that slave trade, that fur trade, for quite a long time into the history of the United States.
Meanwhile, it certainly wasn't being introduced from England, because American slavery was never popular in England. There was no groundswell of popular support in England for slavery. Slavery was what Britons were never supposed to become. And they rather looked down on their American cousins for owning slaves. And it was from Britain that the current of abolitionism came that precipitated the crisis that became the so-called Revolutionary War, or the War for American Independence, which was in part on the part of the South fought to preserve slavery. The independence from Britain was fought to preserve slavery from the growing power of British abolitionism.
That's what you wrote for it, right?
So, yeah.
That's what Gerald Horton.
Yeah.
Okay. Counter-revolution of 1776.
Gerald Horne wrote it, Alan Taylor wrote it. We're all writing it because it's correct. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, we had a number five in the back.
Six.
He was five, six. And who's seven?
Hi. Thank you for your writing your book. I did listen to you on Detroit Today. I listened to it pretty often. And she did ask a question about the penal system.
Mm-hmm.
But one of what I wanted to relate is that Henry Louis Gates has a series out called Many Rivers. And I was listening to the CDs, and I stopped the DVDs. I actually stopped listening to them when they were talking about the groups going, I guess.
The couples?
Yeah, the couples going down, and how they were just ravaged to where, you know, they bed down at night and this was going on. It's just horrendous. Now, I really do appreciate you bringing this out. So my question is, Henry Louis Gates is a historian, and looking at your going a lot deeper into it, is there some type of comparison there to where are you going to expand those tentacles, like Mr. Stevenson was talking about the tentacles that runs from the narrative, the history that you guys were given? So do we see other avenues, like the cable system, for example, because it has to have those linkages?
It's very much part of the story. You know, we tried to fit everything into this.
Volume 2.
We got quite a few tentacles in here. I think that's going to be my answer to that one. It goes in so many directions. And I have been wondering what my next response to this is in terms of where I'm going to put my energies. That we're still talking about what's next. So thank you for that. I feel like we've broken so much ground in this book with stuff that you don't otherwise hear. I think few people are going to read this book except for serious historians and know everything in it. And it's so contrary to the narratives that we've all been fed and learned from movies and TV. So I feel still really committed to getting this text out there however we can. I'm so happy there's an audiobook now, because some people either can't see or just aren't going to be able to read a book this big or prefer audiobooks. We got that going with doing this a stage version in the hope that this is something that schools can pick up with and work on. Just getting this text out right now and discussing these ideas more it's been a remarkable educational experience for us this last year.
Ned, there was a tentacle that you talked about for those who didn't hear the show this morning about newspapers and the press that was significant and maybe illuminating for people, for you to say a little word about how these roots in slavery continue to this very day.
There are all kinds of direct lines. There are so many lines that run from this system to the brutalization of black people today. Mm-hmm. The next work, I'm gonna go back to this gentleman's previous question though, because what we really, in a book this size, even could not do is connect all those lines from then to now. That's a work that we're doing I feel like we're doing it right now, tonight. And watching very carefully what's happening at this very weird moment in American history. In the 5 years we were working on this, one after another thing would pop into the news, like, okay, well, we wrote about this in our book that's not yet out, but people recently learned about the Star Spangled Banner. Mm-hmm. Right, that's in here. The Charleston Massacre at Denmark Vesey's church. Mm-hmm. My God, it's just like and if we'd written this a year, if we'd written this a year ago, it would already, and done that, it would already seem out of date now, because, things are happening so fast. And how to actualize that, there's a whole world of people out there trying to make these connections. So part of this work is researching very carefully what other people are writing, what scholars are saying, and trying to synthesize it in your own head. In the chapter that Frank is talking about, Newspapers as Money as People, we drew on a great historian at CUNY Graduate Center in New York City named David Waldstreicher, who wrote a book called Runaway America, about Benjamin Franklin, newspapers, and money and slavery. Basically, from the beginning of the newspaper industry in colonial North America, the slavery business was a dependable and continuous part of its revenue stream. Ads for either slave sales or sometimes slave hire, or for recapture of runaways, were foundational to building the business of American newspapers. There's just no other way to say it. You find the first newspaper, 1704, the Boston Newsletter, issue number 7, has a slave sale in it. Someone who wants to sell a couple of people, and here's where you do it. Sometimes they would be consigned to the newspaper's office, even when the newspaper man was Benjamin Franklin. Right? Franklin owned slaves. Franklin, the great newspaper innovator. He was also a silent, late in his life, an anti-slavery man, to his credit. But he made his fortunes from his newspapers, and one of his newspapers was the South Carolina Gazette, in which he was a silent partner. And that was just a luxury market for slave owners. It was a fundamental part of American journalism. There's also other angles to this, like the importance of paper, how Benjamin Franklin made newspapers into money, but he also printed the money. He was the major paper dealer, he was the major printer, and he was a paper money man instead of a hard money man. But I'll stop.
So we have three more questions. Marsha, and then here. So we have three more, and
my Q&A's tend to be infinite hyperlink.
That's all right.
I saw the excerpt first of your coffin text on Delancey Place, which was one of the things that really riveted me to your work. I'd also comment that you really are a beautiful singer. and I would be curious as to how you made some kind of obvious, you have some parallel life going on or something. that's just a thing I'm noting. I have an actual question.
Okay. Or
you have just recently been talking about the money just now.
You can't hear humor.
They were just now talking about money and hard money, paper money. And I heard the interview this afternoon in which you talked at length about the role of money, physical money. In the commodification of these human beings, what has been, to your mind, the impact, the result of commodifying humans? Because I think that that's a very profound gleaning from your work that is quite primary, and I think it's a very serious kind of construct, because you're talking about human beings not only being the generators of money and the capital that causes for the making of money, but the money itself.
Yes.
And I think that's a very significant thing. And the other thing I'd like you to address is the transition that took place when slaves could no longer be imported into the country, and this sort of madness began within the United States of this slave breeding as the way to generate increased slaves.
Do you want to hit any of that before I
Going back to starting with the what is the effect of the commodification of human beings as products as opposed to humanity?
Yes.
Or being human beings? What you get is a society like the antebellum South, in which, except for a very small elite, nobody is human.
Okay.
And we do not want for the people who are not ourselves, meaning the people who are the slavocracy elite, we want nothing at all. We want no civil rights, we want no human rights, we do not have them. We do not want clothes, we do not want education, we do not even want infrastructure. Everything is to be extracted from everyone else, and it is all for us. And we do this because we are human and no one else is. And it starts with slavery, but as I don't want to go all feminist on your asses now.
Come on,
but,
with it.
But you know, women face this
understanding in every culture, everywhere throughout history, pretty much. Women have always been commodities in one form or another, and certainly the products of their wombs are like their major value in every culture.